first we have while my wife is just over 12 months since my wife had that terrible accident there, and she was in hospital in Nairobi and in Kisumu, and of course I had to go over there to bring her back and also to look after her while she was there. But you know, while I was there, I ended up strategizing for 3 new church plants that we do in Nairobi. And so we planned them, and then they all kind of started around about the fall. And this year, when I went back, I went back to visit the 3 churches, and all 3 of them are absolutely booming. They really are. So it was great. I did the first anniversary for one of them just the week before last. That was their first anniversary, and they've built a lovely facility. It's a brand new church from nothing. They built a brand new facility. They built a facility. See, it's about 300 people, and and it's just about packed when I was there. And they built a powerful, powerful church, and we did the first anniversary. That's with Pastor Innocent and his wife Jane. Tremendous couple. They're also directors for our college. Our school and the orphanage in Kisumu. But and then the other one is my vice president over there, the vice chairman, and we bought a facility there and built a facility just out on the outskirts near the airport, and we dedicated that last Sunday, and all the churches came together, and it's just incredible. It's wonderful, just packed. And then we in Machakos, just outside of Nairobi, we end up renting a piece of land. And then we put up a big tent. We bought a tent and a container, and the tent was packed with people. You know, this is just 1 year. 3 brand new churches there in Nairobi just in that 1 year. That came out of just Hazel being in hospital there. You know, she was in hospital, gave me 10 days to work with some of our key leaders that were ready to be released. And so just an incredible, and then I met with them on Friday night on the way back. I had a board meeting with them because we had to redesign and reorganize, rewrite the constitution and agreements and everything like that. We put it all back together, and tremendous. And then, of course, in Kisumu, which is where we have the children's home, and we also, remember Pastor Grace that was here?
Yes.
The church that she's the associate pastor of just became a Victory Church. And her pastor was a graduate from our college 20 years ago. And so now he's just officially brought his church in. He's got a group of little churches. They just all brought them in as partners in our Victory movement, which is tremendous. And then, of course, we've got a great church right on the children's home itself with Pastor Luke. And he has a church. He had built a church in Nairobi, and that church is also being adopted into the region of churches in Nairobi. But the church and the orphanage is doing great. They're really doing great. Luke is doing a great job. We had a whole team from Grand Prairie, which is northern Canada, contractors that came over, and they did all kinds of construction. Right now, the students are all out. You know, all of the we have a Christian school there as well, from right from grade 1 right through to grade 12. A lot of the students have gone home to any kind of relative. We give them a time where any kind of relative that they have or friend, they can go and stay with them for a month. And so a lot of the students, we only had about 20 students left there, 20 orphans left on the orphanage when we were there, but it gave us a chance to do a lot of construction. And so the construction teams came in, they rebuilt the classrooms, they fixed any water leaks, put new pipes in, did the electrical, put new ceilings in, and painted a whole variety of places and made the place look real, real good. You know, then one of our couples came over from Spain, our Spanish church in Spain. They came over and they brought, their church brought one of these projectors for the orphanage, a projector that goes on the ceiling. They brought a brand new laptop, put all the programs on it. And so this week in the orphanage, that will be the first Sunday where the pastor will have his message on the PowerPoint, and the worship leaders will have their songs on there. So something kind of new, you know, over there. So it's really tremendous, very exciting time there. And then we bought a Toyota Land Cruiser. Yes, it belonged to the United Nations. United Nations buy some great vehicles. And we bought it from the United Nations, about an $80,000 vehicle, and we got it for $27,000, which is a miracle. It really is. And one of our guys drove it back from Nairobi, and we used that because the roads are pretty rough out there. Mm-hmm. And with a regular car, it doesn't last too long. Even a regular truck doesn't last very long. But these kind of vehicles like this, I mean, man, they'll outlive most cars, you know, they really will. And so anyway, we bought one of those, and that's great for the orphanage, for going out to the farms and bringing up, picking up all of the foods that we need. I mean, these kids, we're not just housing them for 7 days. We feed them, clothe them, teach them, train them. And then we have a Christian school that takes them all the way through, right through high school. And then even after high school, what we do is look after them and so that they can end up getting a profession. So we look after them for 2 years after they're released. You know, we look after them for 2 years to make sure they can get a proper education and somewhere to live, etc. So we look after those kids for years. I tell you, Hazel had to raise all the funds for this, by the way. Yeah. You know, she really did. You know, not only for that orphanage, but also for the one in Rwanda as well. And it just amazed me how the finances came from everywhere. Cheryl is over there as well. She's having a great time. And they left. They left for Rwanda on the Friday night. I came back here, left Friday night, got back here last night about 5 o'clock. And Otis picked me up and always looks after me. But she's over in Rwanda, her and Cheryl. And another part of the team went with her to the orphanage in Rwanda. And she says it's incredible. I don't know if you've seen any of the pictures on Facebook. Has anybody seen any of the pictures on Facebook? Oh, man, you got to go to our California Victory Church Facebook or the International Facebook or the Missions Facebook. And you'll see it's like the Garden of Eden. I mean, you know, she made it so it's all edible landscape, you know, and there's banana trees and avocado trees and there's all kinds of things. Plus, we've got goats and chickens and everything. But it's like the Garden of Eden. I thought, man, that is absolutely beautiful. Now, it wasn't like that when we got it, you know. And she's making the one in Kisumu like that as well. In fact, in Kisumu, you know, one part, they just planted banana trees. I talked to the guy that planted them. I said, well, when did you plant those? He said, well, just in spring. Now they're about 14 feet high and they've got bananas on them. I thought, that's incredible. You know, we've got bananas on. It's only been there for 6 months from a little seed. Now you've got a 12, 13, 14 foot high banana tree. Wow. It's incredible. And so, you know, it's beautiful what she's doing there with the orphanage in Rwanda and in Kisumu. And these are two of her babies, you know, they really are. And we have a church on both of them. She preached at the church this morning there in Nairobi, in Kisumu. She said the place was absolutely packed. And they brought the choirs together. So they had a number of different African choirs, you know, from ours, some of our churches there. And they brought the choirs in, the African choirs. She said it was absolutely incredible. And then she preached there as well. So now we've got a Bible college on that property as well as in Rwanda, they're closing down all of the orphanages so they can go more to the foster care and the adoptions. I think it's a bit of pressure from the United Nations to try and make it into a first world nation, but it's really not working that well. So they're supposed to close all the orphanages down by the December of last year. But they asked us to take the orphans back, some of them, because they couldn't find homes for them. They couldn't find places for them. And some of them, of course, Hazel, she hired a social worker to go around all of the places where these kids had been sent to make sure they were being treated okay. You know, and some of them have come back to see her and Cheryl now that they're there right now. Cheryl's been a major supporter of the orphanage and the business she worked for, her company. They've been a major supporter as well, financially and in every other way, to help make that orphanage in Rwanda become a reality. And so they're there, and they've got 43 Bible college students there in Rwanda now. And we've started a life skills program there, and we started a life skills program as well in the school. In Kenya, got a great guy for the one in Kenya. He's from one of our Canadian churches, and he's a mechanic, and he's also a great general builder. And so, two of the old vehicles, he's got them, and then the kids, he's working with the students. They'll take the cars apart, put the van apart, you know, and they're going to put it all back together so they really work. So he's training them on that. And then we've got a sewing and a knitting school there that is also to help train people. And then we put all of the graduates, we put them all in computer training right now. So we've got a computer school. We didn't have our own school yet, but we put them all into a regular school and paid for them to learn computer and graphics, etc. And that'll be a 3-month program for those kids. So we might end up doing like we did in Pakistan. You know, in Pakistan, what we did, we have 5 major schools there with about 850 students in our schools in Pakistan, if you can believe it. And so what we've done there, and this was Hazel's idea, you know, with the college, with the Bible college, instead of starting a separate Bible college, she just added another year onto the school system, which means the last year of the school becomes the first year of Bible college. And it's all in English. So you do a first year Bible college for every graduate. You know, and there must be close to 1,000 kids there now. You know, so there's always a whole group that are graduating. And this has been the first year, and the leader from Pakistan says it's working incredible. It's great. You know, so Lots and lots of things that are happening all around the world, and you're part of helping to make that happen. You really are. And so it's great. It is a worldwide vision. We have our world conference this coming year. If you can make it, it'll be a great one to go to in July, and that will be on the first church I ever planted. We have 43 acres of land there, and that's where the revival began, really. And it's from there that we went right across Canada, and then from there right around the world. And so I know we're bringing in a lot of our leaders from around the world, and if you can make it up there, you'll love it. You know, you really will. It'd be very multicultural. I don't know if you've seen some of the crusades that Dr. Jay's doing. Have you seen them on Facebook? Yeah. Man, you know, in Agra. Agra is where we met Dr. J, and he's just finished a major crusade there, 10,000 people, and this is in Agra. We were the first ever church, Christian church, ever to plant a church in Agra. That was 7 years ago. We planted a church there. Now we have about, I think we have about 9 in and around Agra, and then he had crusades there for up to 10,000 people. I think we've got about 8,000 people, and 5,000 Hindus and Muslims all received Christ. That was just a few weeks ago. And then this last week, I had them in Siliguri, which is on the border of Tibet, for 10,000 people. And every night, you just got reports, just this last week, while we were in Kenya, I got reports from over there, how that every night there were between 2,500 to 3,000 people that received Christ. You know? Really? You know, and it's tremendous. I tell you, things are happening all around the world. Yeah. I just got a report from the Philippines, from the head of our Philippine churches. He says that they're planting 6 new churches in the Philippines, and one of them is starting, they've got 20 small groups, he says, and they want to start a church out of these 20 small groups, like home groups and life groups. Yeah. And so bringing them together to start one church, and these churches, they start there. Now they're starting with over 200 the first service. The biggest one we started was with 550 people. And so he's starting 6 of those at the beginning of this next year. It's very, very exciting, very interesting. It's wonderful when you can go all around the world and you got a family. Yeah. They're all called Victory, so you got family everywhere. Yeah. You know, I mean, you go and there's a whole group there ready to meet you. Yeah. You don't have to go over there as a stranger. And it's almost like you've known them all your life. Mm-hmm. First time you met them. And they're there to welcome you. They're singing songs, welcoming you, and they take you somewhere. And they got a plan for your life when you get over there. You're not going over there figuring, what can I do? No, there's a whole plan. There's a whole schedule for you. Yeah. I mean, never preached before. You'll preach. Oh, yeah. You'll teach. You'll minister. It's amazing how valuable you can be. Sometimes we think we don't have much, but, you know, just being brought up in the USA or Canada or any Western world, you have skills that you don't even realize. You really do. And you can be of great value. You know? And praise God, this is our special month this month. Isn't this great? Don't you love this brochure? Yeah. Really good. And this book too, you know, Dr. Ron Swanson's wife was with us. The dean of the college's wife was, she was in Kisumu with us. That's the first time she'd been on missions. And she looks after our online college, and she's doing a great job with some of our multimedia people, and they're putting it together, a great online college where you can go on there and you can go right through to get your doctorate, you know, even online. And it's been upgraded incredibly, but this is Earth's final hours. I helped him write this for the last 10 years. We've been working on this, but you know, he's done a great job. He's one of my favorite teachers. And if you go to our TV, you know, Victory TV, our 24-hour Victory TV station, how many have ever been there? Okay, well, if you go to tv.victoryin.org, you can go right to the new TV station that we'll put up. It's a webcast broadcast network, and on it, you'll see Dr. Ron preaching the first 2 lessons. He preached it the last 2 weeks in the Royal Oak Church, which is the first church I planted in Calgary. He preached there for the last 2 weeks, and so his wife could watch it on the TV in Kenya. I brought it up and we watched it in Kenya, the first part of the message. Absolutely incredible. And so if you want to go there and watch the first part of the message, you know, maybe what I can do, if we don't bring him down here, I'll just play one of his messages. Yeah. The first 2 messages, the introductions that he gave, and he did that. It's already up on the TV network. But I tell you what, this is something, you know, there's 2 things that the Bible tells us not to be ignorant about. One of them is spiritual gifts. Don't be ignorant of spiritual gifts. And then secondly, it says don't be ignorant about the end times. Right. What's happening? The hour that we live in. And they're the 2 things you don't hear much preached about in church, do you? Right. When's the last time you went to a church and heard them preaching on the spiritual gifts? You know, the 9 gifts of the power gifts of the Holy Ghost. And yet that's the one thing he says don't be ignorant of. And the second one is about the return of Christ. And you need to understand what's happening in the last days. I mean, pretty much every book in the New Testament ends with the return of Christ. In the book of Philippians, every chapter ends with the return of Christ. It's not just some kind of out there doctrine, a weird doctrine, or some kind of doctrine that's not important. It is vital. It's called the blessed hope. You know? The blessed hope. He is coming back again.
Yes. Amen.
Even when we partake of communion, which we're going to do today. Remember how, you know, with communion, it says we do this in remembrance of him until I come.
Yes.
And so even what we do at the end of this service, we're having communion service, but we're drinking of the juice that represents his blood, eating of the bread that represents his body. And he says, do this until I return. Huh? And so every time we partake of communion, it's until he returns. Without that, what's the point of life? Huh? I mean, if you're just here for 120 years.
Healthy.
Huh? Yeah. I mean, what's the point of life if you just go back to the dust and that's it? Mm-hmm. Huh? There's no purpose for life. Is there? If you evolved from a tadpole or from a monkey, what is the purpose of your life? There is no purpose for your life. Man, you know, people die young because they've got no purpose. A lot of people, that's what they say, people that retire, very often they'll die not too long after that because they have no purpose. Purpose can keep you alive.
Amen.
Isn't there a cause? Yes. Glory to God. You know, so this is a great little book, and this is tremendous. Look at this. You know, this is going to be our theme for this month. And you know what? And I love this because, you know, every great revival is always Christ-centered.
Yeah, that's right.
It's Bible-based,
right.
And it's Holy Spirit-empowered. And I tell you, that's what I want this month to be. This month is going to be, number one, Christ-centered. But it's going to be Christ-centered, Bible-based. And it's going to be Holy Spirit-empowered and directed. And you know, I'm just believing this is going to continue on, not just this month, but I believe all through next year. No matter what area we're covering, no matter what subject we're talking about, everything's going to be Christ-centered, Bible-based, not just psychological mumbo-jumbo. It's going to be Christ-centered, Bible-based, and it's going to be Holy Spirit-directed and empowered. Do you think that's a good idea?
Yeah.
Glory to God.
Yeah.
And of course, here's our key verse. Thanks be, look at the bottom there. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. 2 Corinthians 9:15. Indescribable gift. You know, I wish I could describe him to you. It doesn't matter how much you try. You really fully can't describe Christ to anybody, can you?
Right.
No matter how much you try, no matter how many good things you say, you still can't fully describe him. You know, and now look at this passage of scripture here in the book of John, chapter 20, because I want you to get a little bit clearer understanding of who Christ is. You know, do you know him today? I believe that we only know him partially. The more you know him, the more you love him, the more you'll obey him, the more your life will be fully enriched and fulfilled, and the more you'll accomplish in life. The more you know him. Remember the message I preached a little while ago? I says, the more you know the planner, the more you'll trust the plan. The more you know the planner, the more you'll trust the plan. There's some things that happen in our lives that don't seem fair, they don't seem right, they don't seem just. But I tell you what, if you're serving God, all things will work together for the good. To them who what? Love God, and number two, called according to his purpose. Romans 8:28. Those that love God and are called according to his purpose. So if you love God and you want his purpose more than anything else, it doesn't matter what happens, God's got a plan.
Yeah.
He can make that work for your future. He can make that work for your benefit. Okay, the more you know the planner, the more you'll trust the plan. Just like Habakkuk, though the fig tree doesn't blossom, there be no herd in the stalls, the produce of the olive fails, it couldn't get any worse. He says, yet will I rejoice in the Lord, I'll joy in the God of my salvation. He will make my feet like hinds' feet, and he will cause me to walk on the high places of the earth. You see, he could rejoice no matter what he was going through, because he trusted the planner, he knew the planner. If you know God, you'll trust him, you'll love him, you'll obey him, you'll trust him. The more you know him. And so, look at this verse of scripture here in John chapter 20 and verse 31. John 20 and verse 31. It says, but these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And look at this. And that believing you may have life in his name. So this book of John, he's talking about this epistle here. Talking about the epistle of John. This is why we give the epistle of John to people to read first. Why? Because this book is written for a purpose. The purpose it was written, it says that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. You know, the Bible says in 1 John 5:12, it says, he that hath the Son hath life, he that has not the Son does not have life. So what does that mean? I mean, this word life is, it comes from the Greek word zoe, which is spiritual life. You know, there's at least three words talking about life in the Bible from the Greek. One is bio, which is the physical life, the biological life. The second is psyche, which is the psychological life, the soulish life, the mind, the will, and emotions. And the third is zoe, which is the spiritual life, which is a life. It's your spirit coming alive to God. The Bible says that God's a spirit, and they that might worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And so the spirit part of you is the part that connects with God. I tell you, when Adam fell, it was the spirit that died. In fact, it wasn't dead, it was just separated from God, which is the same as spiritual death. But you know, the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1, it says, you, he has made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sin. And so when you were born again, you were dead in trespasses, and that means a part of you was dead. I mean, I don't know about you, but I know before I was saved, I mean, I picked up a Bible, couldn't understand it at all. Didn't make any sense, you know? It really didn't, but once I got born again, once I received Christ, there was something happened on the inside of me. I had no desire for church, no desire for Christianity. I got no desire for doing good. I got no desire for anything that was right. Huh?
Right.
Except perhaps what my mother and father placed within me, values I picked up from living in a Christian society. You know, but apart from that, you know, there was not something that was innately good that wanted to do. How many know people are not born innately good? No, they're not. No, you're all born. It says you were born into this world, a sinner. My mother conceived me in sin, and in iniquity I was conceived. You know, and so when you get born again, you come alive. That's the spirit that comes alive.
Yeah.
Also, there's a hunger for this word. There's a hunger for knowing God. There's a hunger for church. And there's something that will only be satisfied through getting to know Jesus. Now, in the book of John, so he's talking about the book of John here. This is written that you might know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that in believing you might have life in his name and through his name. That's the reason for the book. And so in the book of John, you'll find in every chapter of the book of John, there's 20 chapters, 21 chapters, and each chapter describes an aspect of his nature, his character, or his ministry. And it's wonderful as you begin to look through it. And you got to remember, and we're going to do that this morning, I'm going to just mention these to you all the way through. 21 chapters here, and I'll do it real quick. You know, but 21 chapters of his nature, his character, and his ministry. And remember when you were in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26, it says that he created man in what? In his image and in his likeness, he created man. And part of the plan of God is for us to be changed from glory to glory into the image of Christ. That's part of the plan. Even as far as myself and fivefold ministry gifts, it says that God's placed us in the body to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Have we arrived yet?
No.
Well, hey, it means there's still a job for the fivefold ministry. It's to train the saints and equip the saints and perfect the saints for the work of the ministry. So that it's not up to the pastors and the fivefold ministry to do all the work of the ministry.
Right.
It's for us to equip you.
Yeah.
So that you can become like Jesus and do the work of the ministry out there.
Amen.
I tell you, we should have over the doors, like Joseph, the sign that Joseph had, you know, Candace's ex-husband there, or husband, you are entering the mission field. Out there, the mission field. We're all missionaries to Orange County. Huh? You're an ambassador for Christ. That means you are here to accurately represent him. And the more we're changed into his image, the more accurately we can represent him. Isn't that right? So that we not only think like him and speak like him and talk like him, but do the works he did when he was here.
Yeah.
It's possible. Isn't that John 14:12? He says, verily, verily, I say unto you. Those that believe will do the same and even greater works will they do, because I go unto my Father. So anyway, let's have a look at this. In John chapter 1, and we see Jesus as the Son of God. The Son of God. There's a different aspect. Number one, in John chapter 1, he's the Son of God. It says in John 1 and verse 1, in the beginning was what? The Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then in verse 14, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus Christ, the Word became flesh. He was the Word become flesh. Remember the revelation that Peter got in Matthew chapter 16, where they're talking about, and Jesus said, well, who do you say I am? Who do you say I am? And he said it to the disciples. And then Peter spoke up and he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God.
Yeah.
And then Jesus said to him, he said, Simon, flesh and blood didn't reveal this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. He had just had a spiritual revelation from heaven. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's the number one revelation we all need to get, isn't it?
Amen.
That's where it begins. And then number two, in John chapter 2, he is the Son of Man. He's the Son of Man. You see him in his humanity. In his humanity, he's all God, but he's all man. Remember in Isaiah 7:14, a child shall be born and his name shall be called Emmanuel. That means in being interpreted, God with us. God with us, chapter 1. But chapter 2, we see him in his humanity. He is the Son of Man. And we see him at the marriage in Cana of Galilee, where they're in a marriage. His mother was there, and then they ran out of wine. Remember that at the wedding? And his mother said, they've ran out of wine. And Jesus said, well, what have I got to do with that? What's that got to do with me? You know, and then he says, my time hasn't come. You know, this is where the first miracle happened.
Yeah.
His first miracle was in his humanity. And then his mother said, he said to the waiters, she said, whatever he does, whatever he tells you to do, do it.
Yeah.
Whatever he tells you to do, do it. And then, of course, they looked at him and he said, these water pots, six water pots, go fill them up with water. And they did, and take them to the host of the wedding. And, of course, when the host poured them out, it was wine. And not just cheap wine, it was good wine. He says, most weddings, they give you the good wine first, and then they give you the rotten stuff afterwards. He says, but here, they gave us the good wine at the end. And of course, that's the water that Jesus turned into wine. That was the first miracle. It really was. I tell you what, it's still true, that same saying. Whatever he tells you to do, do it.
Yeah.
You read in Scripture, he tells you to do it, do it. That is the key to success. It is the key to miracles. It's the key to life. Whatever he tells you to do, do it. You read it, do it. And so it's amazing how he blesses you.
Yeah.
I tell you, without obedience, you always stay in the realm of potential. The person that could have, should have, but didn't. God wants us to be the person that could, we should, and we did. Glory to God. So, John chapter 2, you see him as the Son of Man. John chapter 3, you see him as the divine teacher. Look at this for a moment in John chapter 3 and verse 1. This is really vital. John chapter 3 and in verse 1. So in John chapter 1, he's the Son of God. In John chapter 2, he's the Son of Man. In John chapter 3, he is the divine teacher. A great teacher. Man, I tell you what. I don't know if you've studied the teachings of Jesus Christ, but I tell you what, there's no person teaches like Jesus Christ. I mean, the messages he taught are absolutely incredible. You know, I mean, they're quoted everywhere all around the world, and even not the messages, but phrases. I was sitting next to in the plane, next to an old punk rocker styler. You know, he was from Las Vegas. You know, you know, and he was a pretty wild looking guy, but I had a good talk. I liked him. You know, we got a good talk together, and then he quoted, he says, you know, I love that passage, the golden rule. He says, that's what I tried to live by. I said, really? I said, good. I said, a great rule to live by. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. He knew that because he was brought up in a Christian family. You know, so I really had a good talk to him about Christ, you know, and about his life. But people know the teachings, whether they know it's Jesus Christ that said it or not. Most of the best psychologists are all just doing what Jesus said to do. You know, so, and of course he is the great divine teacher. Look at this in John chapter 3 and verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. You know, Jesus wasn't educated the same way they were. But this rulers of the Jews, this man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God. For no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And then Jesus answered him, Most surely I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus, this ruler, he says, said to him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water, which is the first birth when the water breaks, that's the flesh, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of Spirit is Spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. I love verse 8 too. It says, The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes to. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. So in other words, when you receive Christ, you were born of the Spirit. But it says it's like the wind. What's it like? It's like the wind. You don't know where it comes from. You don't know where it goes to. But you can see what a hurricane does when it leaves. Yeah. You know, somebody sent me a little joke from Canada there. And they're digging their car out of the snow, you know. And the snow's up here and they're digging their car. And it says, thank God we don't have hurricanes here. Thank God we don't have to. That was funny, you know. So even in that, the thanking God. In everything, give thanks. Yeah. Thank God we don't have hurricanes here. I mean, so far down in the snow. Yeah. And so, but you can see the effect of it, can't you? It's like electricity. I mean, you can't see electricity. I used to teach electricity. I used to teach the laws of electricity and magnetism. You know, how that you put a conductor through these waves, something that's unseen, and then all of a sudden it causes electrons to flow, and now you have lights and power and heat and energy, and it comes out of nothing. Huh? I mean, really, coming from that kind of background, it really helped me to understand how Christ works. There's laws that we operate all the time. I mean, the law of gravity, we can't see it, can we? Do you know it's real?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I used to jump off my garage with things on my little wings, you know, jumped out of trees with umbrellas and everything, you know, I mean, trying to fly. That's before I realized there's a law of gravity, that, you know, what goes up will come down. And so, you know, the divine teacher, praise God, he's instructing a master in the Jewish teachings. And so, John 3:3 is a famous verse. Then John chapter 4, he's the great soul winner. The great soul winner. And you see him beginning at the pool of Bethesda. And here's a little woman at the well there. And of course, she draws water for him. And then he says, woman, he says, and she says, he asked her to draw some water. And he says, well, you don't even have a bucket. And he says, look, woman, he says, the water I give you, I give you my water, and if you have my water, you'll never thirst again. I give you living water. And then he said to her, he says, why didn't you go and fetch your husband? And she says, well, I don't have a husband. He says, yeah, he says, you've been married 5 times. And the guy you're living with is not your husband. And then she said, well, I perceive you're a prophet. Huh? I perceive you're a prophet. Because of this revelation, and he showed her the way of salvation. He went 38 miles out of his way to go and meet this little woman who had been divorced 5 times and living with somebody that's not her husband. I mean, she must have been a broken, you know, messed up little young woman, probably very beautiful. But Jesus, he went there. He's the great soul winner. He spent that time with her, showing her the way to salvation. And then she went out and won her whole village to Christ. Brought the whole village back to Jesus. Come here, a man. He'll tell you everything you need to know. Invitational evangelism. And then he said afterwards, you know, he wasn't hungry. And the disciples said, oh, Master, you know, should we go and get you something to eat? He said, no. He says, my meat. He says this in verse 35, I believe it is. In verse 34, he says, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. That's my food. Man, you know, I mean, spiritual food, man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God the Father. I tell you, there's something that happens when you start to do God's will and work. You know, you don't, sometimes you just seem to get nourished. And you know, where you would have normally been physically hungry, you're not physically hungry anymore. Something powerful about that. He's the great soul winner. You know, and we also. It says he came to seek and save that which was lost. Luke 19 and verse 10. And then it says if we follow him, remember Matthew 4, 19, he says, follow me and I'll make you what? Fishers of men. Follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. Because we're created in his image. And he created in his image and his likeness. It means the way that Jesus acted is the way we should act. The way he lived is the way we should live. The things he did are the things that we should do. What would Jesus do in this situation? How would Jesus handle this? How would Jesus, you know, deal with this kind of an individual? And he began to think like that. So we see him as the great soul winner. And then John chapter 5, he's the great physician. Remember at the pool of Bethesda? Here's a man, 38 years, been sitting there. And then Jesus comes along to him at the pool of Bethesda. He says, will you be made whole? And then the man said, I have no man. And because what they were doing, the people were lying at the pool of Bethesda. And it seemed like there was some kind of tradition or something that happened there where the first one into the pool, when the pool was being stirred, got healed. And so you needed a man to get you into the water real quick. And of course he never had any man. He said, I don't have any man. I don't have any man, and therefore I can't get into the pool so I can get healed by the angel. But I tell you what, when Jesus comes on the scene, you don't need a man.
Right.
You don't need an angel. You don't need revival. All you need is Jesus. That's all you need. He's the one that heals and brings healing. And so we see Jesus healing this particular individual. In verse 8, he says, arise up, take up your bed and walk. And then in verse 14, he says, sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you. Basically saying, look, that sickness you got is related to sin. Not all sicknesses, it can be, but this particular sickness was, he says, go and sin no more, lest the worst thing comes upon you. But he's the great physician. He's the great physician, Dr. Jesus. Man, he knows how to heal physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually. And then in John chapter 6, he's the bread of life. You know, he did that when he fed the multitude with 5 loaves and 2 small fishes. 5,000 people. One little boy's lunch. He blessed it, multiplied it, fed 5,000 people, and then told them to go and pick up the fragments. 12 baskets full left over. Shows that how he was thrifty as well. And then in verse 35 in John chapter 6, he says, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. He says, Moses gave you bread from heaven. He says, but, you know, that God had given. Moses gave you bread. He says, but that bread, you eat of it, you're gonna hunger again. Wouldn't he? He had to go out the next day and collect more bread, more manna from heaven, even though it was sent from heaven. He said, but I am the bread from heaven, saying, look, you had manna, they fed you manna, that was bread from heaven, but I am the bread from heaven. He says this, I am the bread, he that comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. Isn't that something? You can drink of the water and you'll get thirsty again. You can eat of bread and you're always hungry. You need more. You got to get more all the time. He says, but he that comes to me, you eat of the bread that I give, you'll never hunger again. I tell you, there is no satisfaction outside of Christ. No lasting satisfaction. It's amazing when you get Christ how little you can be happy with. Isn't it? You know, people that don't have Christ, I've always got to have more of this. I've got to have a bigger house, a bigger car. I've got to have a better holiday. I've got to have better clothes. I've got to have better health. I need more wives. I need more children. I need more this. I need more that. They're trying to satisfy their emptiness in their heart with things out here.
Right.
But he says, look, he that eats the bread that I give, they'll never hunger again. You drink the water that I give, you'll never thirst again. And you can be happy and content with little.
Amen.
I mean, you know, people ask about Hazel and myself when we go overseas and we end up living, you know, I mean, we don't live, thank God this last trip we got the Hilton Hotel in Nairobi. That was Cheryl. You know, Cheryl had points from her business. And so, you know, we just paid a small amount because of Cheryl that came with the Cheryl car. And we were able to get 5 days in the Hilton, which was really nice, you know. You know, we got in the morning, big breakfast, I mean, big smorgasbord. I thought, man, this is pretty good missions, this, I know. this missionary life is pretty good, you know. but, you know, I mean, that's soon finished. And then, of course, you go out into the bush there. Well, must, you know, Kisumu's not really in the bush, but it's certainly a big contrast, you know. Yeah. I mean, I don't know if you've seen any of my pictures with Dunga Beach. Did you see Dunga Beach?
Yeah.
I wondered where they got the name from. A lot of cow pies around there, you know. I you know, Cheryl and Hazel and you know, I called them the Dunga sisters. You know, the Dunga sisters. I says, the Dunga sisters do it again. You know, and of course we had, and then of course there's that hotel I put on there. Remember the hotel, Dunga Beach Hotel? 5-star accommodation in Dunga Beach. It's on our website, Facebook site. And this little hut there. It is the Dunga Hotel. You can see it. So it's the Dunga Hotel. It's a long way from Newport Beach. It's Dunga Beach. But I tell you what, you can be happy. You don't have to be in Newport Beach in a great big mansion to be happy. Some of those people are the most lonely people in the whole world. Some of the most messed up people in the whole world. Don't envy people that got all the stuff. No, really. I tell you what, you'll go through life discontent, the poison of discontent. I want what he's got. I want what she's got. I want this, I want that, I want something. Shut up! You need to speak to yourself. You'll get no satisfaction. No matter how much you try, and I tried, and I tried, and I tried. Huh? Yeah. Well, I tried for 30 years. Thank God after 30 years I found Christ. Otherwise I'd be like the Rolling Stones. They're still jumping up and down at 70 odd years of age, crying out for satisfaction, and still can't get any. Huh? And some of you got relatives and friends like that. Really, I tell you what, we need a real revival this Christmas. Lots of people get saved at Christmas. They really do. Let's just really believe that, you know, even praying in the back room today, I was just praying, I was saying, you know, God, you need to bring back the backsliders. There's so many people out of church that have heard about Jesus in Orange County. You know, really, I mean, how many people were brought up in church? They've heard the word over and over and over again. Somewhere they got stuck. They got hurt somewhere, offended somewhere, disappointed somewhere, and they got stuck. And then they stopped going to church. Then they stopped reading the word. Then they stopped meeting with Christians. Before you know it, they're totally backslidden, away out of God's plan. But it's just like the prodigal son, we end up living in the pigsty, eating with pigs and pig food. And then it says he came to himself. I'm believing that people in Orange County are going to come to themselves, those that are outside the church. Come to themselves. Yeah. Come to themselves. They came to their right mind.
Yeah.
They came into their right mind, it says in Luke 50. Came into their right mind, and then he thought what it was like back in his father's house. He says, man, better even just to be a servant in my father's house than to be outside of the father's house living in a pigsty, in a pig pen. And then he repented, and he returned. And when he returned, his father saw him and welcomed him. Yeah. And rejoiced and put the robes back on him and the signet ring and everything. And then he killed the fatted calf and he had a celebration. Huh? That's what it needs to be like in this church when people come back. People that have been backslidden away from God. We need to thank God they come back. Huh? Isn't that, no matter what they've done. I tell you, God has a place for them. He's forgiven them. And so John chapter 6. He's the bread of life. Let me show you scripture here. This is in Amos chapter 8. Amos 8. This is prophetic, I believe, for where a lot of people are at right now, especially in North America. Amos chapter 8. I could quote this for you, but I want you to read it. It says, "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst of water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea, and from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but shall not find it. In that day the fair virgins and the strong young men shall faint from thirst." So look at this. You know, I mean, there's going to be a famine of hearing the word of the Lord. Not a famine of bread, physical bread, not a famine of water, but a famine of hearing the words of the Lord. Even in North America, I mean, there's a lot of churches that are not really preaching the word. They might be good motivational messages to motivate you. But it says people in the last days are not going to endure sound doctrine. They're going to look for something that's going to tickle their ears. I tell you, we got to be careful what we're listening to. You know, I read a story about an account of a chaplain who was the chaplain in some kind of home. or prison or wherever it was, but they found rats in this place. And so he said, well, you know, there's children here, I can't put poison on the floor. And then he found out what they could actually put that would kill the rats. And so they found a substance that rats become addicted to the place where they become so addicted to this substance that to the exclusion of every other kind of food. But this food has no nutrients in it, no nutrients at all, and they become addicted. This is all they want, and they'll bypass all of the good food just to get this junk. And so what happens in a short period of time, the rats die. And they die of starvation. And I thought, man, I tell you, that's a pretty good description of North America. Mm-hmm. You know, people get addicted to junk food, spiritual junk food, so much so that they end up bypassing everything else. And of course, it's one. You won't endure sound doctrine, just the teaching line upon line in the Word of God. We don't want to hear that anymore. You know, we want something fresh and something new and something's going to tickle our fancy. If we want something new, why don't we just go back to the Book of Acts? I tell you, we don't need something new. We need something. We need an innovative return to the traditions of the past. Innovative return so we can apply what worked in the New Testament to our lives right now. We don't need new stuff, just innovative return to the things that we know. Glory to God. So, the bread of life. So, but look who faints here. It's the young man. I mean, the fair virgin, the strong young man shall faint from thirst. And so these are the ones that will hurt. It's our sons and our daughters, where God says he wants them. Acts chapter 2, I'll pour out my spirit in all flesh. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Young men will have visions. Old men will have dreams. On my handmaidens, I'll pour out my spirit. That's God's plan. That's God's plan. You know, but on the other side of that, in the last days, many will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And I tell you what, two things happening. And this is talking about the other side, the thing that happens for those that are not seeking after the word. They're going to faint. They're going to run to and fro. I mean, even me, 30 years of age, I'm still wandering around the world. I mean, drove all the way through Africa in my Mark 10 Jaguar, smashed it all up, turned around, went back to Europe, traveled all around Europe, and then came up to Canada, traveled over around Canada, then I bought a Volkswagen van, went down, driving down to Venezuela. Yeah, I was heading to Trinidad. Yeah, and but I got 14 miles the other side of the Panama Canal, there's no roads. I didn't foresee that. It's just jungle. You can't get through there. Even bulldozers couldn't get through there. And so then I tried to sell my van in the Panama Canal so I could sail back up the coast. And nobody would buy it, so I had to drive it all the way back. And then when I got back, I got reunited with Hazel in Vancouver. And she'd just been born again. Just been born again. She's saying, Lord, if you got a man for me, send him into my life. Just been born again a few weeks. And the phone rang and it was me. I said, Hazel, is that you? She said, George, is that you? I said, yeah. I said, just amazing. That's a miracle, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't know where she was. She's from Australia, I'm from England. We'd lost contact with one another. I'd just come back from South America. And she was living 3,000 miles away in Ontario when I left her. And then God brought us supernaturally back together. Yeah. And then after 18 months trying to get her out of Christianity, I realized it was true. Yeah, I tried everything. Until finally she said, George, I love you, but Jesus comes first in my life. You can go, but I know you'll be back. And when you come back, we'll serve Jesus together. And I slammed the door and left. 15 minutes, came back. Yeah. See, by that time I knew it was true. That was like my ace in the hole. You know, I felt for sure she wouldn't leave a nice guy like me for this Jesus. When that didn't work, I tell you, that's when I thought, man, she's real serious. And then, of course, by that time, I realized the word was true. And the book of John is what helped me. This book of John, I've got great revelation at this book of John, because that's what it's written for. You might know that he's the Son of God. And so he's the Son of God in verse chapter 1. He's the Son of Man in chapter 2. He's the divine teacher in chapter 3. He's the great soul winner in chapter 4. He's the great physician in chapter 5. He's the bread of life in chapter 6. And in John chapter 7, he's the water of life. Verse 37, if any man thirst, let him come to me and drink, for out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Glory to God. This spoke he of the Spirit, it says, of those that would receive him. the spirit on the inside of them, like a river that flows out. Remember that song we used to sing, there's a river of life flowing out from me, makes the lame to walk and the blind to see, opens prison doors and sets the captive free. It's the river of life. It goes in and it comes out in your speech. And then in chapter 8, he's the defender of the weak and the fallen. And you see a woman caught in adultery, in the very act of adultery, it says. And then they said, Master, what do you say about this woman? And they said, the law says stone her. What do you say? And he says, well, and then he began to write in the sand. And then he said, let him who has not sinned cast the first stone. And of course, one by one, they all walked away. he's probably writing their sins down in the sand, you know, one at a time. You've done this, you've done that, you've done something else. And they all walked away one at a time. You know, and then he said to her, woman, where are your accusers? She said, I don't have any. And he said, go and what? Sin no more. Go and sin no more. I tell you, every time we sin, every time we choose to sin, we choose to suffer. You know, and we end up in positions that, you know, that we really regret. You know, so, and number 9, he's the light of the world. John chapter 9, a blind man there, and he spits in the clay, rubs the clay in his eyes, says, go wash yourself. In the pool of Siloam, he washed himself, and his eyes were cleared, and he could see. And then he said, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. So when Jesus was in the world, he was the light of the world. But then what? Then what? After he left, then what? Yeah, well, then he said in Matthew chapter 5 and 4, now you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. He was the light of the world. Now, when we got born again, remember what happens? Life comes in, the light goes on, the life goes out. Life comes in, the light goes on, life goes out. All of a sudden, you understand what life's about. You understand you understand the plan of God clearer, which helps you understand what's happening in the world. Man, it is pretty scary living in the world today if you don't know Christ and you don't know how it all turns out. That's why this book is exciting. Matthew 24 and verse 6, it says, wars and rumors of wars, kingdom against kingdom, nation will rise against nation. It says there'll be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in different kinds of places. Then in verse 6, right in the middle of it, it says, but see that your heart's not troubled. Huh? Because it says the last days, people's hearts are going to fail them for the fear of those things that are coming upon the face of the earth. If you don't know how it turns out, and you don't know what you're supposed to do to be prepared for it, man, you could die of the fear of some of the things that are happening. Yeah, you'd stay locked up in a cellar somewhere. Huh? I thank God my wife didn't let that last experience cripple her. She got out of that. Praise God. So let me just run through these others real quick. He's the light of the world, and now we are the light of the world too. Light drives out darkness, doesn't it? Drives out darkness. Not only that, it exposes darkness. You know, and it repels darkness. And also reveals that which is good. And then chapter 10, he's the light of the world. He's the good shepherd. He says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. So in John chapter 10, you see Jesus as the good shepherd that gives his life for the sheep. And he laid down his life for you and for me. The good shepherd. Remember Psalm 23, the great psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. Personal. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I tell you, that's powerful. The Lord your shepherd, I shall not want. He leads me by still waters. He makes me to lie down in pastures green. Glory to God. He knows where the food is. He knows the food to nourish your soul. You need to call it. You make sure he's a personal my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. And then in John chapter 12 and John chapter 11, he's the resurrection and the life. Lazarus is dead 4 days. And his body was stinking in the tomb. And then Jesus came down and he says, Lazarus, come forth. Immediately, life comes back into Lazarus and he comes jumping out of the tomb, bound with graves cloths. He said, loose him and let him go. You know, and then he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whosoever lives and believes in me shall never, ever die. I remember as a brand new Christian seeing that verse. Whoever lives and believes in me shall never, ever die. I thought, wow. I always thought, I'm here for a little while, then I'm gone. But then you think, well, what? There's got to be more to life than that. You know? I was so happy when I found out that he whoever lives and believes in me shall never, ever die. You know, every one of us, if we live long enough, we'll end up burying somebody we love.
true.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
You know, and even Christmas time, like now we're coming up to Christmas, many of you have lost loved ones in the last year or two. You know, but how wonderful it is when you get to Easter and all of a sudden you're celebrating the resurrection. It's not just this, the resurrection. Man, I'm going to see them again. You know, the dead in Christ shall rise first. We which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the clouds. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Comfort one another with these words. He says, we're not like those that in the world that have no hope. When somebody dies, they have no hope. They're just sorrow, and there is no hope for that. They're just sorrow. There's no hope of ever seeing them again. I mean, what a horrible kind of a thing. He said, but you, we're not like that. We know, 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18. It's powerful. In John chapter 13, 12, he's Christ the King. Palm Sunday, a week before the crucifixion, you see him coming down, and they're all happy and excited about Jesus riding on a little donkey in fulfillment of prophecy in Zechariah 9 and verse 9, and you see him there, people worshiping him, praising him, saying that he is the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. And they're praising him and waving the palm branches and praising him. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. 1 week before the crucifixion. Next week, they're crying, crucify him. I tell you, the glory of man is pretty short-lived, isn't it? Eh? Everybody likes him while they're scoring goals. But just let them, you know, have a few dry seasons, not too long before they want to crucify him. You know, and the glory of man is short-lived. It really is. I tell you, this way you've got to live your life for the glory of God, not the glory of man. And then in John chapter 13, he is Jesus the servant. And as he begins to wash the feet of the disciples. And then Peter said, Master, not just my feet, but my whole body. You know, he wanted everything. First, he didn't want Jesus to do it. Then he said, no, if you're going to be that, give me your whole body. And Jesus said, no, you don't need your whole body washed. Just your hands. Just your feet. What it was. And then Jesus, he did it. He says, I do this as an example for you to follow. This was an example. If you will serve. He's saying, basically, it takes a free man to serve. You know, people can make you a slave, but they can't make you a servant. A servant's a choice. Jesus humbled himself and became a servant unto man and unto God. I tell you, we need to become servants so that what we do, we do it in servant. For all of you that work in the church. You know, I mean, hey, you're not, I really appreciate everything you do as far as helping and serving, but I tell you, you're not doing it for me. You're not doing it for me. I tell you, when you serve here, whatever you're doing, ushering, greeting, singing, helps and hospitality, cleaning, whatever you do, you're not doing it for me, you're doing it unto the Lord. And he's going to repay you, not me. Isn't that right? It says, Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 10, it says, he's not unrighteous to forget those of you that labor, you know, to help and minister to the saints. He's not unrighteous, and he knows how to bless you and look after you. So if you're serving, don't get bent out of shape if nobody praises you.
Right.
Huh? He might be doing something that nobody sees.
Right.
Therefore, nobody really recognizes. But you know what you're doing, and so does Christ.
Yeah.
And he's the one that will reward you. In John chapter 14, he's the great consoler. Remember that? He just told them he's leaving. And he says, don't let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe in me also. He's getting ready to go to the cross. And he still takes time to comfort and console and encourage his disciples. And then in verse 7, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And eventually in that passage, he says, if you knew where I was going, you'd rejoice. He's getting ready to go to heaven. They're sorrowful about it, but he said, look, if you really understood where I was going, if you understood, he says, you would rejoice. Glory to God. Man, I'm going back to be with my Father at the right hand of the Father in glory. And then in John chapter 15, he's the true vine. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He says, without me, you can do nothing. But then he says, if you stay hooked up to the vine, if you abide in the vine, whatever you ask will be done from the Father for you. And so he's talking about being connected to the vine. He's your source of strength. He's your source of fruit. It's a life-giving source. It's just like a branch. You pull it off of the tree, it might have fruit on it, doesn't it? You can pull a branch with apples on it, and the apples will stay on there for a few days, and they still look healthy for a few days, but what happens eventually? The branch dies and the fruit with us. Huh? And that's like Christians so often. We'll pull ourselves away. We'll disconnect ourselves from all of the connections that God desires us to have. That's what communion is about, once again. communion is so we can get reconnected, get our heart connected back to Jesus, get our heart connected back to the church, get our heart connected back to the Word, so that we can stay fruitful and alive and on fire. I'm the vine, you are the branches. John chapter 16, he's the giver of the Holy Spirit. I will send him to you. Praise God. I'll send the Holy Spirit to you. And when he comes, he'll not only be with you, but he shall be in you. He's going to be in you. He says, when he comes in you, the Spirit of truth will be on the inside of you, and he will lead you and guide you into truth. The Spirit of truth, the comforter, the advocate, the intercessor, the standby. I'm going to send him to live on the inside of you, and he will show you things to come, it says in John chapter 16. That's what you received when you received the Holy Spirit, when you got born again. You received the Holy Spirit. You know, the Holy Spirit in you, the Holy Spirit with you, and then when you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit upon you. Glory to God. Then John chapter 17, you see Jesus as the great intercessor. Now these are all things, these are aspects of Jesus Christ's life and ministry. We are being changed into his image, in his likeness, being changed from glory to glory. When we need to look at these, are you the bread of life to some people? You know, I mean, we can give life through what Jesus Christ has given us. Freely you've received, freely give. You become a receiver of life, a receiver of blessing, receiver of healing, a receiver of a whole variety of things. Now you become a giver of life, a giver of blessing, a giver of healing. And so he gives us the Holy Spirit. And I thank God for the Holy Spirit. I really do. Yes. You know, I thank God for the Holy Spirit, and he gives you the power to be able to do what you need to do. That's why we need to stay full of the Holy Spirit. Micah said, truly I'm full of power by the Spirit of God. Huh? And then John 18, he's the model sufferer. Remember, as he's suffering there on the cross, and he said, Father, if it be possible. Actually, this is before he got on the cross. He says, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And then he submissively drinks of the cup of suffering, laying down his life for the salvation of the world. Wow. I tell you, the hardest thing you'll do in life, I think, is surrender your will to the will of God. One of the hardest things. Father, I really don't want to do that. That's what he's saying. If it's possible. He's saying, is there another way that man can get saved? Can they get saved by keeping some laws, keeping some rules, doing some religious kind of activity? Can that give them eternal life? If there was another way of man receiving, they couldn't even keep the Ten Commandments. Even in the Old Testament, nobody got saved. Nobody could keep all of those Ten Commandments, could they? That's why they needed all the blood sacrifices. That's why they had to kill an animal. You know, I mean, they had to kill an animal and shed an animal of an innocent animal. Their blood for your sins. You know, and then, of course, Jesus' blood is better than the blood of any animals. And his blood cleanses and purifies us. It really does. But nobody got saved but through keeping the law. In fact, in the Old Testament, they had the written law and they had the sacrificial law. The written law was guidelines so that you wouldn't hurt yourself. But if you did miss it, then there was the sacrificial law. And that was the answer. If you sin, I'd better get an animal real quick. Get to the priest, get an animal, and shed, you know, and that blood will cover my sins. Didn't save you. It just covered your sins so you didn't get struck dead. But in the New Testament, we're living in a different dispensation. And it says, we can be saved just through receiving Jesus Christ and that alone. You know, in John chapter 17, you see him as the great intercessor. In John chapter 18, the model sufferer. And the model sufferer, where you see him suffering. But I tell you what, he laid down his life and he did it willingly, didn't he? And then in John 19, you see him as the uplifted Savior. As he's uplifted and put to the cross, put on the cross there. And then he said in John chapter 3, even as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And then he goes on in verse 15, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And of course, we talked about that before, how Moses made that brazen serpent. And that was lifted up. And when people looked at that brazen serpent, it says they were healed. And that brazen serpent is still the emblem that the doctors use today. And it came from the book of Numbers, chapter 21, where Moses made the brazen serpent. They were all being struck with poison, and they're all dying. And every time when they looked to the brazen serpent with a steady, absorbing gaze, they were healed. And doctors still have that symbol today of their profession, to bring healing. But there's a serpent. Why a serpent? I mean, the serpent on the pole, I mean, that's a sign of sin, isn't it? It says, he who knew no sin was made to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. 2 Corinthians 5:21. So he became sin, and that's why the serpent on the pole. You look to him and healing can come. And so the uplifted Savior. And then John chapter 20 is the victor over death. He's not here, he has risen. Peter, it says that when they got the news from the guilds, it says Peter and John ran. It says, but John outran Peter. Do you ever wonder why that was in there? I mean, John outran Peter. This is John chapter 20 in the first few verses. It says, John outran Peter. My goodness. You know, I mean, I tell you, there's something about passion and fire. Man, I'm not going to be last to church. I'm going to be first. Huh? I'm not going to be last to the prayer meeting. I'm going to be first. Huh? Do you think he cares? Well, I mean, it's in the Bible. It says how John outran Peter. Let's be excited about what we got. Let's be enthusiastic about what we got. Let's not be lethargic, you know, about our Jesus. And John chapter 21, he's the restorer of the repentant ones. And I just want you to look at this, and we'll close with this. In John chapter 21, he's the restorer of the repentant ones. I think I missed that one chapter, and that was John chapter 17. If you want to put that down there, he's the great intercessor in John chapter 17. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. He's the giver of the Holy Spirit. He's the giver of the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 17, he's the great intercessor. Remember his intercessory prayer? Powerful. As he began to pray, and he prayed five things for the church. He prayed five things for us, for you, and even he says he even prayed for those that would come to know him. So he even prayed for you before you were saved. Right. So he knew who was getting saved, and he prayed for you even before you got saved. But, you know, in John chapter 17, you see how that he prayed the intercessory prayer, and he prayed, number one, he prayed that we'd be united in love. Number two, he prayed that we'd experience his joy. Number three, he prayed that we'd know the word. Number four, he prayed that we'd reach the whole world with the gospel. And number five, he said he prayed that the glory that's upon him and the Father would be upon us, the church. Now look at this in John chapter 21. Let me just finish with this. John chapter 21 and verse 15. This is after his resurrection. He's the restorer of the repentant ones. I tell you, Peter must have felt like a failure. Huh? Can you imagine how Peter was feeling? I mean, he denied Christ three times, even when he never thought he'd ever do that. But in front of a little servant girl, denied Christ three times. And then, you know, and then he went back fishing. He thought he'd blown it so bad that he could never be trusted or used again. But then in John chapter 21 and verse 15, and I love it also in the book of Mark, where Jesus said to the ladies, he says, you go tell the disciples and Peter. Go tell the disciples and Peter, made a special emphasis about Peter because, you know, he knew how Peter would be feeling. And so in verse 15 it says, this is now the third time Jesus showed himself to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said to him, feed my lambs. He said to him again a second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know I love you. He said to him, tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he had said the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Most assuredly, I say to you, when you were younger, you girded yourself and walked where you wished. But when you are old, you will be stretched out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish. This spoke he, signifying by what death he would glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said to him, follow me. And so this here, you see Peter thought he'd blown it so bad. But Jesus is coming back to him. He's saying, Peter, do you love me? You know, Jesus went, do you love me? He's saying the word agape. Do you agape me? And Peter answers back. He says, yes, Lord, you know I phileo you, which is I have a friendship love. Agape is an unconditional love. Agape actually means to love unselfishly to the point where you'd be willing to sacrifice. Agape that's what agape is. Phileo is just to be a friend or to have the same kind of interests as another person. You know, and the different loves that are mentioned here are vital. It says, Simon said, son of Jonas, do you love me more than these? Do you agape me more than these? And he said, yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you. I love you as a friend. And then he said, feed my lambs. And then he said to him again a second time, do you love me, agape me? And he said, yes, Lord, you know I phileo you as a friend. I don't love you unconditionally. And then he says, tend my sheep. And then he said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, do you phileo me? Are you my friend? And Peter was grieved, and he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, you know all things. You know that I love you. Phileo you. He said, feed my sheep. And so, in other words, Jesus came down to his level. You know, he was not at the place in his life where he could come up to the level that Jesus wanted him to come up to. So Jesus came down to his level, accepted him at his level, but then he said, but look, Peter, you know, this is what's going to happen to you, and in the end of your life, you are going to sacrifice for me. You're going to love me so much that you will lay down your life for me and count it an honor. In fact, Peter was crucified upside down. They wanted to just crucify him, and he said, no, I said, I'm not even worthy to be crucified the same way that my Lord was crucified. And of course, then they crucified him upside down. And so he did experience that. But you know what? It says, you know, if you suffer for Christ, it says the Spirit of glory will come upon you. And you see many of those old martyrs that died for Christ. I mean, some of them sawn in two, thrown to lions, all kinds of stuff happened to them. But you know what? It seemed like everyone they killed, there'd be another thousand that stood up and accepted Christ. Because they saw the joy. Some of them burned at the stakes and waving their little stumps around after their arms had been burned off and praising God. And the glory of God was seen on their faces. You can read Fox's Book of Martyrs. All of those, and they're still dying for Christ today. In the Middle East, they're still, just for owning a Bible, they can be killed in the Middle East, put to death, you know, in the Middle East. You know, and so many Christians in the Middle Eastern nations are being totally persecuted, being killed by family sometimes. And so it's still happening all around the world today. It's just that we're not experiencing it. Why? You know, I mean, hey, because, you know, because of the roots of this nation. It's freedom because of Christ. One nation, under God, indivisible. You cannot divide it from liberty and justice for all. Once you take under God out, then you're dividing the nation. It's divided and cut off from the liberty and justice for all. And so, Father, we say thank you. I thank you, Lord, that through this, I thank you, Lord, we can get to know you more fully. I thank you, Lord, even all of these 21 chapters, Lord, where you're revealed in a different way. I pray to you, Lord, that you cause each and every one of us to be able to see you with a new light and a new understanding. I thank you, Lord, that for those that need to know you as the Lord, our shepherd. I pray to you, Lord, that you'd lead and guide. For those that need to know you as the Lord, our peace. Father, let peace rule and reign in this place today. And Father, even as we have communion this morning, I pray to you, Lord, that you would cause, Father, the power and presence of Almighty God, Father, to bring healing and wholeness and life by the power of your Spirit in Jesus' wonderful and powerful and mighty name. Thank you, Lord Jesus.